to the Oxford Martin School. I'm Ian Golden, I'm the director of the school. And it's a huge pleasure this evening to introduce Michael Osborne. Michael is the co-director of our program on technology and work, which is a five-year program which started, I guess, a year ago, is it? So it's 1 year into a five-year program, already producing fantastic work, and there's some examples of it outside, including the work that we've been doing together with Citi, sponsored by Citibank. Today, Mike is going to talk about a much broader set of topics. He's also an associate professor in the Department of Engineering, a machine learning specialist that's just spun out together with some others, a company called Mind Foundry, which maybe you'll say something about, and is really at the forefront of thinking about what machine intelligence can do, how it might affect work, and the much broader questions about what technology and society might look like over the coming decades. And that's the focus, or a focus, of the Oxford Martin School's work. So absolutely delighted to have you, Michael. He'll speak for about 45 minutes, and we'll have a chance for a discussion.
Thank you. Thanks, Ian, and thanks to all of you for coming along. So as Ian said, my remit today is the whole of machine learning, so you know, no small topic. I'll do my best to tackle that, but I will give a little bit of a plug for our program here in the Martin School on technology and employment towards the end of the talk. And for that reason, despite the fact that it's me standing up here, I've also got Carl Frey's name up on the slide, the co-director of our program here in the Martin School. So I think I have a clicker. Right. So I thought I'd start out by defining machine learning, given that it's a relatively new field and perhaps one that's unfamiliar to many of you. So my best definition of machine learning is that it's the study of algorithms that can learn and act. And while I say that's the best definition I have, it's still a fairly unsatisfactory one. For the reason, firstly, that learning itself is not necessarily a completely crisply defined activity. So I don't think we necessarily have a great idea of how we learn as human beings. And the second reason I think the definition is a little bit unsatisfactory is that even what we do know about how humans and animals learn is not necessarily a good model for how machines currently learn or even should learn. So there's, you know, it's a little bit misleading to some extent to think of these algorithms as reproducing human faculties in all their details. So to try and bring out some of these, to bring out this definition, I thought I'd try and give as concrete an example of what machine learning does as possible. And to highlight in particular one of the canonical problems for machine learning introduced in the 1980s to sort of break the field into the broader public consciousness. And it was that of classifying handwritten digits. So this is a problem that was faced by people like the US Postal Office, by companies that have to process checks. And the problem was that people had thought about tackling this problem using predefined rules. Some would have sat down and said, well, a one kind of looks like a vertical line. So you will have said, if this image falls into the category that is defined by having white on its left and right-hand sides and is mostly black in the middle, it's a one. And you can see immediately, I think, by gazing upon the example images of handwritten digits that I've put on the slide, why such an approach might fail. So the problem is humans in writing digits are not very regular. Any predefined rule is likely to fail, you know, due to the variety of images that are produced. So there was really a demand to be able to draw upon data to inspect examples of handwritten digits in the process of designing a system that could recognize those as digits. So the way this problem was tackled by pioneers like Jan LeCun was to draw upon what has come to be called machine learning, a much more data-driven statistical approach to these kinds of problems. So the general process of machine learning is to amass a sufficient quantity of data that can serve to teach an algorithm about the patterns within it. And again, I'm using a word teach that is a little bit ambiguous, but in this example, to be completely concrete, we had a data set in which there are a lot of examples of pre-labeled zeros, a lot of examples of images of ones, and so on and so forth. Each of those classes known to the algorithm as being emblematic of those classes. So drawing upon that data, the algorithm could begin to classify, to cluster together instances of similar images, and use that to provide its best guess for the identity of any previously unprovided test image, such as I've given you on the right-hand side of the slide there. And you can see there the difficulties of the task. That was in fact a 2, but could very easily have been misconstrued as a 7. So, these techniques kind of got their big start in the 80s, as I said, in tackling these kinds of problems. But it's important to say that, you know, this also illustrates the limitations of machine learning. So here we are classifying handwritten digits, but that's a long way away from learning how to play the piano, from creating a novel piece of artwork. All of those things are still far away from what the kind of state-of-the-art machine learning is able to achieve. And to distinguish one from the other, and this is a theme to which I'll return, for handwritten digit recognition, we've got a large amount of data which crisply defines a fairly narrow problem. So here, all we had to do was to classify an image into one of 10 classes, and we had a lot of examples showing us how that could be done. So that's really what machine learning is about. It's separated off the broader generalities of intelligence and learning and focused in on these quite narrow problems that we can actually make progress towards. So as a result of that kind of approach to intelligence, machine learning has come to surround almost all aspects of our digital lives. So perhaps you're aware of where machine learning is being used in some of these places. Perhaps you're not, so I thought it might be worth flagging it up. One particularly ubiquitous example is that of spam classification. So your email client or your email provider will automatically be labeling emails as either spam or not, based on the characteristics of the words used in that email. So here is an actual spam email from my junk folder, and you can see the fact that it contains the words Viagra and Cialis is a pretty good indication that it's not something that I would necessarily need to read. But of course, the way that succeeds is through the provision of large data sets. So these algorithms are taught the difference between spam and not spam by giving it a sufficiently dense representation of those two different categories. Some other examples, so photo tagging on Facebook or through Google is done through machine learning techniques. These can operate in a classification style approach, labeling the contents of an image, but they can also be used to flag up, for example, faces in parts of the image. All of this is machine learning. All of it, as I say, is solving relatively crisply, narrowly defined problems with access to large amounts of data. And the final example on the slide is that of product recommendation, something that has really been driving the commercial success of machine learning over the last decade or so. And so if you've used Amazon, you'll have had it recommend to you products. And the way they're doing that is by drawing upon your spending patterns, the kinds of things you've bought in the past, and comparing those against the spending patterns of their millions of other customers, finding customers who are somewhat similar to you so as to be able to recommend appropriate products. So all of that, even if you weren't aware, is machine learning in the world right now. But to talk about some of the work going on machine learning in this university and to give some more examples of exactly what it is, I'd like to refer to a sensor network that's particularly near and dear to my heart. It's the one that drove most of my own DPhil research. So this is a network of wireless weather sensors deployed off the south coast of the UK. These sensors depicted on the right-hand side of the slide are reading things like tide height and air temperature. And they're then transmitting those readings to a server in Southampton, which then uploads them to a website, bramblemet.co.uk, for anybody in the world to check out. And this has real useful applications to people like the port authorities, to recreational sailors. The sensor network is not replacing the weather forecast made by the Met, but it is providing very local, recent measurements of these kinds of things. So to show how machine learning fits into the picture, I'd like to focus your attention on those little dotted red lines. Because the problem we faced in this sensor network was that while these sensors were making regular readings of what was going on, often transmission from those sensors back to the base camp in Southampton was interrupted due to adverse weather conditions or something else. So every now and again, we would get what's known in the field as missing data. We didn't get readings that we actually wanted. And as a result, we would have to use algorithms to infer or make a decision about what the readings actually were, even in the absence of that relevant data. And to tease out the second part of the definition I gave you of machine learning earlier in the talk, there was also an action or decision problem we were faced with in this setting, in that these sensors being remote from human activity, that is, they're floating out off the coast. They're powered by a battery pack, effectively. And this battery has only a finite life, and transmitting a reading back to the server in Southampton draws a non-negligible amount of that battery energy. So the decision problem we were faced with was, what is the most useful information to transmit? We don't just want to transmit everything we get, because a lot of it is going to be redundant. It's going to be as we would have expected anyway. We only want to transmit the information that is surprising in some sort of way. And that is a decision problem, again, that's relatively crisply defined and one to which we can address the tools of machine learning. So now onto some videos. So this is a graphical representation of the BrambleNet network. The red crosses that you see in these four different plots are the readings returned by the four different sensors at four different locations. The x-axis is time, and what I'll do is set the video running so you can see how this plays out, much sped up, obviously, relative to real tide heights. Is that working? There we go. So I've also overlaid a black line, which gives us the ground truth for the tide heights. That's not available to the algorithm. That's something that we've got from tide tables later against which to compare our predictions. And we've asked the algorithm to produce predictions in the form of that blue line you can see. That's its best guess for what's going on in the absence of readings. I'm sorry that video is so jerky. I'm not sure why that is. Anyway, so you can see there are periods of missing data just after the first peak and the second peak, where we weren't getting those red crosses containing observations. And we didn't do so well in that first period of missing data. We did a lot better the second time around, at which point the algorithm had learned from the data that this was a relatively periodic, predictable kind of pattern that it could easily reproduce by exploiting the periodicity. So we see another period of missing data just after the third peak there. That's just in the 28th of May. In that Bramble Bank sensor, you can see a long period of blue without red crosses representing observations. So that was due to an interesting weather effect, a storm which swept in and knocked out transmission from that sensor. So the storm, unfortunately for us, resulted not just in missing data, it also resulted in an abnormally low tide. The water was actually pushed out to sea by the storm. So you can see that if all this algorithm was doing was learning about the periodicity in a tidal signal, it would be unable to pick up the fact that this tide was unexpectedly low. Nonetheless, in this period, as you can see, our predictions are remarkably accurate. The blue line is almost spot on the black ground truth. And the reason for that is this algorithm has got another faculty. It's not just predicting on the basis of an individual sensor, it's fusing the observations from all the four sensors so that in the absence of information from this sensor, it's able to infill more or less what it's seeing at the other three. It's exploited the fact that all these four are correlated. We haven't told the algorithm that they're correlated. It's learnt that from the data and done the right thing in consequence. And here, for some reason, I'm also showing results from air temperature where we've done more or less the same thing. So this is what I mean by learning. Here we're not just learning a class label, we're learning what the patterns of tide height are. And if I skip ahead to the next slide, let's see if I can do that. Maybe I need to click over here. No? All right. I'll get on to this second faculty of machine learning that I mentioned, that of making decisions. So here, what we're going to do is ask the algorithm to pick the red crosses that it really, really wants, to pick the observations that it's going to transmit back to Southampton. And you can see that to begin with, it's choosing a lot of those red crosses because to begin with, it really doesn't know what the patterns of tide heights look like. It's having to select more observations so it can pick that up. As time goes on, it reduces its rate of sampling because, of course, this is a relatively periodic, predictable pattern and it can get away with less information than it needed additionally. And the other thing you'll note is that after some time, it stopped sampling from the two sensors in the east, Chichester, if I'm saying that correctly, Harbour and Bar. Now, the reason for that is, again, an interesting physical phenomenon, which is that tide in the Solent sweeps in from west to east. So the tidal signal in the east, in those Chichester sensors, is delayed by about 15 minutes relative to the tide in the west. So the algorithm has picked this up from the data. We haven't told it about that a priori, and it's made the very sensible choice, the decision, to focus its sampling, focus its attention on the West, where it really will gain the most information. So this is obviously something that's interesting to recreational sailors, as I said. This kind of prediction of time series is found in a wide range of different industrial applications, finance being perhaps a particularly important application where you might want to predict something like the returns. So very much a technology that's finding real-world application. I thought I might just mention one other bit of research from our research group, which was looking at information of another type, which is that provided by humans. So to motivate why that's an interesting thing to do, I want you to reflect upon the challenge that is facing astronomers today, which is that they're swamped with data. They're swamped with pictures of galaxies. And of course, there are far more of those pictures than any expert astronomer could ever sit down to classify by hand. So instead, what people are turning to is instead the legions of enthusiastic amateur astronomers who are out there and are willing to donate their effort for free to classify these images. But of course, the task doesn't end there for the astronomers, because those labels that humans are providing are not necessarily so reliable. You need to make sure that what's fusing that information together, in exactly the same way that we were fusing together information from multiple sensors in that previous example, is honestly reflecting the kind of fallibility of these human amateurs. So to give you some idea of just how fallible particular humans can be, what I've got at the bottom of the slide are the reports made by different clusters of human amateur astronomers. So we've had to first identify these clusters or communities of users that behaved in similar sorts of ways, exactly the same kind of thing that Amazon is exploiting in making those kind of recommendations of products to its customers. And what we see if we do that kind of thing is that we need to be treating these communities very, very differently. So there are some people, like the sensibles on the far left-hand side, who give us a score of -1, meaning that they think it's definitely a galaxy that doesn't contain a supernova, when the true class is 0, that is, the galaxy actually doesn't contain a supernova. And when the galaxy does contain a supernova, when the score is 1, the true class is 1, that gives a score of 3. So they're relatively well calibrated to the truth. They're great. But unfortunately, what we also get are people like the extremists who will be correctly calibrated in that way, but never acknowledge any kind of uncertainty about their judgments, which is in practice a little bit unhelpful. Then we get other even more problematic users who always tell us that it doesn't contain a supernova, the negatives, or always tell us that it does, the optimists. So as I say, we need to treat those different sources of information in very different ways. So now, speaking to the broader theme of this talk, I wanted to reflect on how these kinds of technologies are already finding impact upon societal ends. And I've flagged up some examples from this university because here we are in Oxford, why not? But all of these, I think, are quite important and exciting applications for these technologies. So at the top left, I've got the picture of a mosquito, which might not reveal very much about how machine learning is relevant. But there's a project led by my colleague in the machine learning research group in Oxford called Humbug, which is aiming to use the sound of a mosquito's buzzing to classify whether or not that is a malaria-bearing mosquito. So the goal here is that potentially you could have a little device in someone's home which is listening out for that telltale buzz of a mosquito and can then classify it automatically as being something that you might actually want to respond to eliminate mosquitoes that could cause malaria, or perhaps don't have to be too concerned about. So malaria is obviously a real-world problem, and one to which, in this case, machine learning can very much help. Education, and this talk will focus a little bit on education later, is something that, again, is having to respond to the changing availability of technologies. And one particularly exciting technology emerging to contribute to education is that of MOOCs. So massive open online courses. Perhaps you've heard a little bit about MOOCs already. And the exciting thing about MOOCs is that in delivering information at scale and enabling people from across the world to access really high quality education from the best lecturers without necessarily having to go to one of those particularly elite institutions. But of course, there's enormous possibilities for exploiting the data generated by these platforms to do some quite exciting things. So we had a project in conjunction with the Oxford Internet Institute to look at how the data characterising how students in some of these MOOCs interact in the fora, the forums that serve as the kind of peer learning platforms for these kinds of MOOCs. So it turns out that people do interact with those platforms, interact with their peers through those fora in very different ways. And by doing the same kind of community cluster detection that I mentioned in the previous example, we can begin to think about targeting pedagogical strategies to particular students' needs. And to me, that's a really exciting thing about MOOCs, that use of machine learning as kind of an interactive tutor, delivering exactly the material that's most of use to a particular student. And then at the far-hand side of the slide, we've got an example from a project I was involved in during one of my postdocs called ORCID, which was aiming to use data from the Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan. So here, people were getting radiation measurements from their smartphones. It turned out not to be too difficult to equip smartphones to make those kinds of measurements. And what we were aiming to do is to fuse together all that different data to provide as accurate a forecast as we can from the radiation exposure at any other point in space and time. So very much the kind of techniques I was drawing upon before to deal with sensor networks, but here put to real positive societal use. So there are enormous positive potentials for machine learning, but of course it'd be remiss of me not to mention the potential risks that machine learning and related technologies might pose to society. There are many of those that I won't get to talk about in this lecture, so I'm going to skip over entirely the potential of machine learning algorithms to invade our privacy, to perform profiling. I won't tackle military robotics. All of these are really important areas that I'd encourage you to read up on. Instead, I'm going to focus on the core topic of our own program here in the Martin School, that of technological unemployment. So this issue of whether or not an algorithm or robot might do your job is one that is receiving a lot of popular attention at the moment. We've seen this cover image of The Economist reporting on our own work, but we've seen perhaps less considerate work in many other branches of the popular media. And we've also seen the World Economic Forum in Davos just a couple of months ago putting this right at the core of their agenda. So, of course, the first response you might have to this question of whether or not an algorithm or robot might steal your job, replace human labour, is to say, well, this has never been a problem in the past, which is true. So to put one particular stat to this, to that intuition, in 1900, about 40% of all workers in the US were engaged in agriculture. At the end of the 20th century, that figure was less than 2%. So a completely seismic change in the nature of employment in the US as a result of technological change, the introduction of new agricultural technologies like tractors. Nonetheless, we didn't really see an enormous spike in unemployment as a result of those technologies. So the unemployment rate at the beginning of the 20th century was about 5% and was still about 5% at the end of the 20th century. So the question for our program is whether or not there might be something different this time. Is there something unique or different about machine learning technologies that might break that pattern of employment resisting technological change? And our thought is that actually there might be something different this time. And if I was to put why we think that into a single sentence, it would be that, well, historically, technologies have been replacing manual labor, like those farm workers who were replaced by tractors. But now, machine learning technologies are able to make these intelligent decisions, are able to replace cognitive work. And to the extent that they're replacing both cognitive and manual work, it's much less obvious what will remain for humans to do. But of course, there's a question associated with that, which is, well, why would you want to replace human cognitive work with an algorithm? I mean, humans are pretty good, right? Humans are fairly naturally adept at learning and acting. So in answer to that challenge, I'd like to point to the following plot from one of my favorite studies of all time, which shows the fraction of time that a cohort of judges awarded parole to parole seekers as a function of the ordinal position during the day. So the y-axis is that fraction of time they made the favorable decision, and you can see that early on in the morning, they're very favorable to those parole seekers. That wears off as the morning wears on. They're perked up by their morning coffee. only for that to last a relatively short time before, you know, the morning wears on again. Lunch perks them up only very temporarily before more or less everything post-lunch becomes a complete write-off. So I'm aware we're somewhere very far to the right of that particular plot in the day's proceedings. So I'm going to have to beg your own generosity in appraising this talk and judging what I'm saying. But there is a real point I'm trying to make here, which is that the decisions that humans make are corrupted by all kinds of heuristics and biases. And there is a real need for us to come up with principled algorithmic alternatives for these kinds of decisions. So that's the first reason I say you might want to prefer an algorithm for decision making to a human. And the second decision, the second reason, of course, is that algorithms are increasingly cheaper than human work. And there are two kind of collaborative forces at play here. The first is the declining cost of computation. And I have an example of exactly that on the slide. You've probably seen many plots like this in the past. So the y-axis here is the cost of a single unit of computing. It's a log scale. And the x-axis is time all the way from 1940 to the present day. So you can see there has been this really long-running decline in the cost of computing, with a single exception there, perhaps, of the iPad 2. But equally important to the decline in the cost of computing has been the rise of what's come to be known as big data. So big data has been vastly overused as a phrase. It's now over the hump of the Gartner hype cycle, as some of you may be aware. But to give you some kind of quantification of exactly what's going on here, let's consider the following estimates of information content. So the first is that the information contained in all the printed material in the world today is about 200 petabytes. That's an enormous number. There was another estimate made of the information contained in all the words ever spoken by human beings, another enormous number, 5 exabytes. But our best estimate for how much internet traffic there was last year dwarfs both of those figures. So our best guess is that there was something like 1 zettabyte of internet traffic. So we really are seeing data at a scale completely unlike anything we've seen in the past. And to my mind, algorithms that are able to use that data to enable decision making are almost surely going to have impact on employment. So to give some concrete examples of where big data is already leading to the automation of previously human tasks, consider machine translation. So for a long time, the translation of written text from one language to another was seen as almost completely impossible to automate. So what people were thinking is that a human translator has to draw upon all kinds of cultural nuance in order to perform their task, that not being something that could be readily reproduced in software code. Nonetheless, of course, there are services today like Google Translate, which do a pretty good job. They're not perfect, but they do go a lot of the way to reproducing that particular task. And the success of these kinds of algorithms has been very much driven by big data. So Google Translate, for example, draws upon 200 billion words from the UN, and that's just one of its data sets. So the UN is required by its charter to translate all its official documents into its 6 different constituent languages. So if Google needs to translate a phrase that's found in one of those documents, it's got ready-made access to 5 translations without that algorithm needing to understand anything at all about the cultural context in which that phrase was found. So I'm not saying that that can do everything, but it's able to do enough to automate much of the task. We've seen impact already in legal professions. So in document review, algorithms now are able to outperform paralegals, which when you think about it is perhaps not very surprising. Algorithms are just much better at processing a large amount of data. There are other algorithms that are being used to prepare contracts. There are firms like Contract Express that exist for exactly that purpose. But there are even more exciting projects out there. So big law firms like Allen & Overy are making use of algorithms to answer quite complex multi-jurisdictional legal questions through access to data characterizing the experts of legal, characterizing the opinions of legal experts. In a similar way, we're seeing the automation of accounting and auditing work. So last year, there were 48 million Americans who used software like TurboTax to prepare their tax returns. There are other firms like Cashflow, which are delivering algorithmic solutions to the processing of invoices, the handling of expenses. And then there are, again, even more exciting projects. So on the right-hand side there, I've got PwC's Halo for Journals platform, which is tackling head-on the problem of auditing. So a human auditor is restricted to really only looking at a small sample of a company's financial data. But an algorithm, of course, can look at 100% of that data and flag up any anomalies. But even more excitingly, that algorithm is not restricted to just doing that once every quarter or every couple of years. That algorithm can be running in real time. It can be constantly processing financial data and flagging up any anomalous behavior instantaneously to demand corrective response. We've also seen the automation of a lot of logistics tasks due to the rise of autonomous vehicles. And I know there's another lecture in this series from Professor Ingmar Posner, who co-leads the mobile robotics group in our department, which I very much encourage you to attend. But these kinds of technologies are already being used to automate tasks like the delivery of meals and medicines around hospitals, as you can see the cuddly little QC bot doing in the top right-hand side of the slide. We've seen the automation of mining vehicles. So this is a mining vehicle from my native state of Western Australia, very much cheaper than a human driver in that particular setting. And in the left, we've got Oshbot, which is being used not just to make recommendations to customers when they enter a hardware store, but actively to guide them to the right place in the store to purchase that product. So you can see that very much automating away some traditionally sales occupations. So this slide is basically an ad for Ingmar's talk later this term. So what we've got there is the Oxford robot car. But again, I wanted to flag up the importance of data to what has happened in this kind of space. So really the success of autonomous vehicles in navigating their environments has been driven by the availability of increasingly precise maps of the road networks that those vehicles are likely to traverse. So Google is perhaps one of the leaders here, and it's no surprise that the firm that has those Google Street View cars driving around the road networks of the world is using that and many other data sets to enable its autonomous vehicles to navigate in an autonomous way. So, of course, that kind of approach breaks down when things are unlike the maps that have previously been gathered. And here I just wanted to flag up one of our own pieces of work in this space, a collaboration with the Mobile Robotics Group. So what we're interested in doing is flagging up roadworks, which are, of course, a place where autonomous vehicles might otherwise have a bit of difficulty, those road networks not necessarily being reflected in the prior maps that have been gathered. So here we were thinking about what data we could use to help that vehicle in its task. And the first one, of course, is looking at the cameras on the vehicle. And we were kind of trying to flag up bits of the images that are recorded that are indicative of roadworks, things like that little blue sign that you can see boxed in the left-hand, upper left picture there. But doing that, it turns out, is not perfect because the algorithm is also flagging up things like the side of the red car in the bottom right as being pretty close to a roadwork sign because that's also red. So we needed more data. So we turned to another possible source, which was the Oxfordshire County Council website. So the County Council puts up on its website reports of where and when roadworks are likely to take place. Unfortunately for us, it turned out that those roadworks reports are not always up to the minute accurate. So they're often not put up until a little bit after the roadworks have actually started, and they often stay up on the website until long after they've finished. So here, there was very much a role for machine learning techniques in fusing together these disparate sources of information where no one of those pieces of information was entirely reliable. That's exactly the kind of thing that our techniques are quite good at. But moving on, I wanted to mention that it's not just the case that these vehicles are the beneficiaries of big data. Looking further ahead, they're going to be very much the sources of big data as well. So these vehicles, in recording their environment, using those onboard cameras that I was mentioning on the last slide, but also using LiDAR sensors and the natively integrated GPS these vehicles have will be giving us an unprecedented view on what's happening on our road networks. So you can imagine that having consequences for mapping, for insurance, for law enforcement. If they spot a criminal in the act, they might be able to call upon the police straight away. But there might be some unforeseen consequences as well. And to make that point, I want to refer to the Chelyabinsk meteorite from 2013. So I'm not sure if any of you remember that event, but if you do, it's probably because you saw one of these amazing images that were widely reported of the meteorite actually striking that remote part of Russia. So these are, as I say, remarkable images, but the reason we have them is due to the fact that there's been a breakdown of trust amongst Russian drivers. So it's become common amongst Russian drivers to outfit their vehicles with dashboard cameras so that if there is an accident, they've got some video record of what's happened so they can take that to the courts. So they're recording their environment in very much the same way that autonomous vehicles will be doing. And of course, it's only because of those cameras that we have these amazing images of enormous benefit to science. So who knows what else might be unlocked as a result of that treasure trove of data recorded by these vehicles. So now on to the particular question I posed. Will an algorithm steal your job? And of course, working in machine learning, my approach to that problem was, well, maybe we can use an algorithm to tell us. Maybe we can classify the automatable jobs from the non-automatable jobs. But of course, to do that, we needed data. So the approach we took was to look at data drawn from the US, which really has the most finely grained, most up-to-the-minute data available on what's going on in employment. And in particular, for 700 different occupations in the US, we had quantitative measures of the skill requirements for those jobs. So I've got some examples on the slide. So the skills we had measurements of, these were all numbers between 0 and 100 to give you some sort of calibration, recorded things like the requirement for a job to be persuasive or to require originality or to use fingers in a dexterous way or to operate the fine arts, which as you can see didn't flag up too much for many of these particular occupations. So what we did then was to provide our algorithm a training set in the same way that in that first example we needed to give the algorithm examples, emblematic training data, teaching it the difference between zeros and ones. Here we have to flag up occupations that are most characteristically automatable or not. So we held a workshop in Oxford, we asked the experts and came up with the labels in that middle column there. So a one means that we thought the occupation was automatable, zero means we think it's non-automatable, and on the basis of our training set, which was 70 of the 700 occupations, we ran our classifier to predict the probability of automation for any other occupation. So you can see the results for a range of different occupations there. You can see we labeled data entry keys as automatable, and lo and behold, the algorithm came back to tell us the probability of automation was 99%. But it was also able to use that to say that people like tax preparers were probably also automatable. Also, umpires and referees, interestingly, their decision-making being relatively routine according to the data set we have. At the other end of the scale, we told the algorithm that people like clergy were non-automatable, and you can make your own judgments there of whether or not that was actually reflective of the truth. And the algorithm came back and told us that, in fact, that occupation was non-automatable, and similar occupations, according to its metrics of skill, like choreographers, were also non-automatable. But there were some surprises that I did want to mention. This algorithm is not just slavishly following the labels that we provided. So one particular interesting example is that of waiters and waitresses. So we told the algorithm that waiters and waitresses were non-automatable because we were thinking that the kind of small talk that a waiter or waitress makes at the table of their customer is not necessarily something that an algorithm can readily replace. So we told the algorithm zero, it came back and told us that the actual probability was 94%, and at the time we kind of wrote it off. We thought, well, okay, maybe it's wrong in this particular instance. But actually, since 2013, when we did that original analysis, we've seen restaurant chains like Applebee's or Chili's in the US
putting tablets, Zeos tablets, on their tables. So these devices are able to take customers' orders, they're able to make recommendations of products to the customers, and they're also able to take payment, automating away much of what a waiter or waitress might once have done. But in fact, they're not just automating in the sense of replacing a waiter or waitress, they're actually doing, in some cases, a slightly better job. So there was an interesting fact. It turns out that if a customer has had a relatively large main, say the carbonara, they're relatively disinclined to then order a large dessert if they have to make that order to a human wait person. But if they can admit that desire only to the tablet that's on their table, it turns out they order a lot more desserts. So in some of these restaurants, dessert orders have gone up by 30% as a result of these devices. Another example of the power of automated solutions. So I'm going to skip quite quickly through the remainder of my slides. The headline finding here for the US turned out to be that there was a very large chunk of employment at risk, and I won't really have time to speak to the different colours, but the headline figure that was widely reported was that 47% of current US employment was at high risk of automation over the next 20 years. Note what that figure is not saying is that 47% of workers will be unemployed in 20 years. We're focusing our attention here on the technological possibility of automation. So we weren't considering all the other factors that come into play in influencing whether or not a job is actually automated. We're only considering how the technologies we already know exist might come into play in the workforce 20 years hence. We've also rolled this analysis out across many different nations. These are the results from our most recent GPS for a range of developing nations. You can see that Ethiopia has 85% of current employment at high risk. And of course, naturally, we reproduced the analysis for the UK, where we found 35% at risk. I don't want to dwell on the differences between those numbers, but I did just want to show the following plot, which was produced by our colleagues at Deloitte, which gave me a bit more confidence in the conclusions we'd drawn. So what this plot shows is on the x-axis, the probability of automation, which I should have said is the same as the x-axis on those previous plots. But on the y-axis, it shows the actual change in employment in the UK over the last 15 years. So what you can see is that over to the left-hand side of the plot, there's been net job growth. There have been, in fact, 3.5 million jobs created in the occupations that we'd highlighted it as being at lowest risk of automation. But for those jobs that we'd flagged up as being at high risk of automation, over on the right-hand side of the plot, we can see there's actually been net job loss over the last 15 years. So there have been 800,000 jobs lost in those occupations that we'd expected to be most automatable, giving us some assurance that this is not just completely unconnected to reality. There does seem to be some impact of these technologies on actual employment. Now, I also wanted to mention the following stat, which is that yes, there have been new industries emerging from new technologies. That's, of course, the other side of this coin. It's not just that technologies are replacing jobs, they're also creating entirely new jobs. But the concern that many people have highlighted is that actually there don't seem to have been as many jobs created by these new technologies as we've seen in the past. So if you think back historically, let's take a current firm like WhatsApp. WhatsApp, at the time of its purchase by Facebook, at which it was valued at 19 billion US, had 55 employees. So that entire company could very comfortably fit into this room. A more old world player, like the fashion retailer Gap, to take one example, had a similar valuation, about 19 billion US, but has 137,000 employees. So these new firms have not been big generators of job growth. And these new results from my co-director Carl Frey put further icing on that particular cake. So this table shows the fraction of jobs in the US that are involved in new tech. And I won't make that definition more crisp because it's a little bit complicated. But so in the 1980s, about 8% of the US workforce was engaged in those new tech jobs. That figure went down to 4.4% in the 1990s. And throughout the 2000s, it was as small as half of 1%. So there is a real challenge here. These new industries may not be generating all that many jobs. But the final point I wanted to make is that the kind, sorry, my apologies for running a little over, are that the jobs that have emerged are actually those that we do want to be encouraging. So the other thing we were quite keen to identify in our original work was the characteristics of jobs that were not going to be automated away. So we set out to identify what we called bottlenecks to automation and flag up two in particular, so creativity and social intelligence. So what I mean by those things are not to say that no automation is possible in this space. It's perfectly possible to design an algorithm that's able to serve as a chatbot, replacing some element of social intelligence, but you're not going to be able to design anytime soon an algorithm that is able to perform persuasion or mentoring or tutoring, to give a particularly relevant example to this university. And in a similar way, in creativity, you can design an algorithm that's able to churn out an endless sequence of songs, but it's very difficult to teach that algorithm the difference between a hit song and a dud. And the reason for that is the kind of data we have in these spaces is much more limited than we have in the kinds of applications I was describing before, and the problems are much less crisply defined. It's much more difficult to come up with a definition, representable and explicit computer code, of what distinguishes a good song from the bad. And for that reason, progress in these spaces is much more difficult. But that's a good thing, I think, because actually, these are the characteristics of jobs that I think we as humans most enjoy. I think being creative, being social, these are the things we do in our spare time. These are the characteristics of jobs that we actually enjoy. And if we look at the kinds of, if we look at the kinds of jobs that have emerged out of nowhere over the last 15 years, they're jobs like iOS developers, or social media interns, or even Zumba instructors. Beachbody coaches is another example, where all of these jobs, I would argue, contain one or more of those facets of non-automatability. They're all creative to some extent, as I would argue an iOS developer has to be in thinking about what app will be most appreciated by the market. They're social, as a social media intern certainly needs to be, or as a Zumba instructor needs to be. So I would argue that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that the jobs that we're automating away are fundamentally jobs that we don't really want humans to do. I would say that the big picture here is that machine learning is actually removing jobs that are to some extent below the dignity of human beings. So fundamentally, I think we should support these technologies, but we do need to make sure that the societal outcomes that emerge, in particular the threat to those who aren't necessarily able to get jobs as iOS developers, are met, that the wealth that's created is equitably shared. So thanks very much for your attention. I think that's all I have time for.
Thanks very much, Mike. It's always very reassuring to know that the creativity of academics will be something which we last beyond the next decade with. So we have some time for Q&A.
Because one of the categories you put up was that for a job that appears highly automatable was referees, right?
Yeah.
Which like on the surface makes a lot of sense, like they're abiding by rules. But it's interesting to me as an American looking at what you call football here, that things like instant replay, etc., haven't been adopted, right?
Yeah.
And that we aren't after what is the objective, reality of what happened, and that, instead we seem to be after, this sort of flow and perhaps like having that human accountability for having erred is almost a role that person is taking on. So I just wanted to put that to you and suggest, like, how, I mean, because accountability is something that a machine cannot take. And how does that fit into this picture?
Firstly, it's an excellent point, and I think it's for exactly that reason that I was at pains to mention before, that our analysis up until now is only focused on the technological possibilities of automation. What we're yet to tackle are all those other factors that influence whether or not a task is actually automated. So referees are a good example of where the technology might exist, but where it might be opposed due to, you know, various stakeholders not wanting that to take root. So I'm delighted to announce that we actually have a new project affiliated with our program, which is looking at automation in primary healthcare delivery in the UK. And I say that's interesting because I think primary healthcare delivery is an area where actually the technological possibilities for automation are pretty large, but where historically there's been a lot of opposition from GPs associations, from patients, to the introduction of that technology. So what we're hoping to use this new project to do is to better understand the characteristics of tasks that are not automated solely due to that kind of public opposition, and to begin to provide a more holistic view of where automation actually takes root. But if you'll permit me to say one more thing, you said that algorithms can't be accountable, and I did want to challenge that a little bit, because to me, there is the possibility with an algorithm to be even more transparent, even more interrogable than a human being is. And I would point to the human judges making decisions about parole that I mentioned before. I think actually algorithms can be explicitly designed to achieve the outcomes that we really want, not just according to the whims of a particular human on a particular day. So I would say that there is hope actually in these spaces. There is promise from using these algorithms.
You took the example of songwriting.
Yeah.
I would have thought that there was so much data available on the number of songs ever written by humanity,
right,
that you'd have a huge data set to be able to generate an algorithm which could make a good or bad song.
Yeah, absolutely true. But what's useful is, what's important, sorry, is not just the volume of the data, but the ratio, if you like, of the volume of data and the volume of the space that's required to be explored, and the complexity of the task that's required to be achieved. So it's all very well having all these songs, but it's still very difficult to say just how good a song is. I'm not sure that goodness of song is a thing that can be measured on a single axis. And
you could have a song which, you'd have a record of songs which have hit number ones, for example,
yeah,
as classified as being good songs,
yeah,
as opposed to those which are not.
Okay, so let me concede that that's possible. And you know, it may, even if, so it would be possible to design a utility function that is just the financial value of a song. However, the action space is enormous. There are so many possible songs. The way humans create songs is by combining ideas from many different areas. It's not like humans just look at rock songs in writing a rock song. They might be inspired by songs from other genres. They might be inspired by a painting. They might be inspired by architecture, or what they had for dinner the previous evening. So the way we're creative, by bringing ideas from many different sources, is something that we're completely unable to do with an algorithm, because these algorithms are working on very crisply defined data sets, and that's really not how humans create.
Okay, let's go there, and then we'll move around right at the back.
If we had enough data, do you think an algorithm can ever rule a country?
So there's an argument to say maybe to do a better job. I don't know. I mean, ruling a country obviously requires a lot of the social intelligence that I mentioned before that's relatively non-automatable. I think there's a lot of high-level persuasion and negotiation involved in, you know, bringing together coalitions of stakeholders, and I think that's non-automatable for the foreseeable future. But in particular aspects in deciding on economic policy, perhaps there is a role for more automated solutions.
Wait on. Sorry, Clara.
Thank you very much. So I was wondering about this prediction about waitresses. So how did you come up with that prediction? And specifically, I'm interested in like various pieces of evidence. So on the one hand, you can have like theoretical evidence. So that's sort of like you're labeling, different jobs as, more or less routine. right? So that's a bit similar, I take it, to this like this example in the at the beginning with the Czechs, where you have like some theoretical reasons to think that, you know, the one is sort of like, you know, have black on the one side, black on the other side, and then white in the middle. Yeah. And then you have sort of like empirical evidence where, you know, the algorithm looks at all of these numbers and then it's like comes up with this idea that, well, this is how these people usually write one. So, and the analogy here would be then that, you know, it would look at like previous years and you know, try to find a pattern that it seems now that, you know, waitresses are getting more and more an automated job. So like, to what extent did it look at empirical and theoretical evidence, and also how reliable are these estimates?
Yeah, so our motivation for not looking at historical data in this context was that our expectation is that many of the technologies we're thinking that will have employment impact, and autonomous vehicles are perhaps the best example, haven't yet had impact on employment. So there's nothing in the economic data we can gather that will tell us about whether or not truck drivers are going to be replaced by a self-driving car. So we were explicitly trying to do a prognostic exercise looking further ahead. So for that reason, we were drawing upon the best data we had available to us, which was the assessment of experts. And you could argue that maybe we should do more of that and speak to a wider variety of people, and that's exactly what we're trying to do. But at the same time, we are also trying to see what historical data could tell us. And one of our DPhil students, Logan, sitting over there, is doing exactly that. So you might be interested in having a chat to him later. So I think it is very important to tackle this issue from many different directions, but I would still defend the approach we took in the first instance.
Thank you very much for a stimulating talk. I wonder whether you've thought about the future social impacts, in the sense that if you look now at status differences in society, they very often actually swirl around whether or not a product or a service is done in a mechanized, industrialized way, which is the cheap, low end of the market, versus a kind of craft, individualized, traditional way of doing things, which tends to be at the high end. Now, are we going to see the same thing with the distribution of machine learning, that there's actually a kind of inverse status to not using machine learning?
Ah, so I'm not sure if this is your question, but certainly I think it is true that we'll see that kind of factorization, if that's a word, that kind of replacement of craftsmen, you know, hand bespoke design of particular tasks with more automated solutions, even in cognitive labour. So I think the professions are an excellent example, where professional services up to this point have been delivered by experts in a particular domain, doing things in a really one-on-one sort of basis. And increasingly, like the accountants and auditors I mentioned before, that will be delivered in a much more automated, routine way by algorithms, effectively. You're also talking about status, but status is due to scarcity in many cases. And it's all very well having scarce skills, but if they're not valued by the market, I can't still see those being associated with high status.
Yeah. I was just wondering, have you done much sort of research in algorithms writing algorithms?
Absolutely. So this is a really hot topic in machine learning, as you might guess. There's an entire field called probabilistic programming, which is attempting to tackle exactly that problem. The idea that the entire structure of a program can be configured to the characteristics of the data set in front of us. But, you know, taken more generically, what you're talking about in algorithm writing itself is really what machine learning is about. I mean, machine learning is the distinction between code that is written once and used thereafter according to those static rules, and code that is actively adapting to what is detected in data. And that could be seen in a sense as that algorithm rewriting itself to suit whatever it detects in its environment.
Thanks. Your example about the waiter and the waitress and discovering the unexpected finding that people ordered more pudding, those examples are really interesting because they suggest unexpected findings and they suggest unexpected impacts of humans. And they're also interesting because it's debatable as to whether or not that's a good thing. It's good if you want to sell puddings. It's not such a good thing if you want to solve the obesity crisis. Right. So is there any research going on which is trying to examine those unexpected impacts of whether it's a human or a machine, and how you might assess whether or not it's a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, of course, it's very difficult to tackle unknown unknowns. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, we're certain there will be all these kind of ancillary side effects with the interaction of these technologies. I'm not sure we really know what they'll be to any degree. I think our hope is just that, you know, by making these algorithms as transparent and as interrogable as they can be, we can design them to achieve the ends we currently know we want. And if there are other things that emerge, the ability of these algorithms to be reconfigured to those new emergent desires will make them a better alternative to humans, who can be a little bit more set in their ways.
On the broader point, though, of the broader social and other implications of technological and other changes, that's the current theme of our research call that we've done at the Oxford Martin School. So every year we're doing new calls, and this year's call is on unanticipated consequences of technological advances. So we'll be looking into that.
Hi, you're predicting the future, which is a bit of a mug's game. We, you know, 20, 30 years ago, we were talking about the paperless office, and that hadn't happened at all. People talking about people only having to work 3 days in a week, and we all still work 5 or 6 day weeks. And I think that the headline, that the thing's got a lot of people interested in this research is the headline figure of 57%. And the backup for all this is your study, is that PwC, you said that there is a general shift towards these sorts of jobs that you're predicting.
Yeah.
Does the scale of that prediction back up the sort of, you know, the massive change you're talking about in the next sort of couple of decades?
Well, I mean, so I don't want to come across as lacking humility in these predictions. I totally accept your point that we have to be conservative in predicting the future. All I can say is that everything we were trying to do is probabilistic, in the sense that we are acknowledging that kind of uncertainty. We're reluctant to say that any job will be automated. We're limiting our attention to, up until now, as I say, the technological possibilities rather than whether or not these jobs will actually be replaced. So while I accept your criticisms, I think we're doing everything we can to be as rigorous in these predictions as we can. I think up until now, the predictions that were made were not built on quantitative foundations in the way that we're trying to provide. And I think any foundations of that sort are better than none. So that's how I see us contributing.
Yeah. Hey, if we do run off the assumption that we're going to be losing somewhere between 30 and 50% of our jobs in the next few decades, this might be a bit of an unfair question, but I don't know if you have thought about what steps we could be taking now to mitigate any negative consequences of that possibility.
Right, well, I'm going to be a bit unfair and first of all challenge your assumption, because as I say, I don't know that we will see mass unemployment as a result of these technologies. While I've said that the new industries are emerging aren't employing many people, it still seems to be the case, and we need better evidence on this, that they do have quite a large multiplier effect. So a new tech job in Silicon Valley is associated with something like 5 service jobs around it. In the developing world, a new tech job is associated with maybe 20 jobs around it. And it's not really clear if those new jobs might offset the loss of jobs elsewhere. There are all these factors at play. But having said that, if I concede your assumption, I absolutely think we need to prepare for the possibility of people being unable to find work as a result of these changes. I think there is the demand for policy responses, in particular to tackle the inequality that might emerge. And I think the best way to think about that is to start small and build out. So I don't know that there is a silver bullet solution. If there is, we certainly haven't found it. So I think we want to try a range of different policy responses in relatively limited trials, and then enact the best to tackle the problem at large.
I mean, this is the subject of a 5-year work program that we've just initiated at the Oxford Martin School, of which this is the first year. So a lot of the subsequent years, which Carl and Michael are working on, also looking at things like what can cities do, what the implications for education systems, things like that. So, I mean, and it's happening here, but it'll also happen in other places, I think.
Yeah.
So we saw from your information that the farmers, that example of the farmers over the 100 years, didn't lead to too much increase in unemployment. And so effectively, you would assume there's a skills transfer or a skills change. Mm. Going forward, people talk about technology increasing, getting quicker and quicker, the rate of change.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think that, or do you see that the people's ability to change the skills of their job or the skills that they grow up with through yeah. our education system is needing to change faster and is changing as yeah. fast?
Yeah.
And then sort of second part of the question is, do you think that humans are actually going to try and slow down some of the implementation of that change? For example, policies against driverless cars, and whether that might actually be a way of controlling whether humans are able to change their skills quickly, as quick as technology is changing.
Right, so a few things in response. Firstly, in answer to your final question, I hope we don't oppose the introduction of these technologies. I mean, my day job is in machine learning, and I certainly wouldn't be developing these technologies if I felt that there were, you know, net societal negatives associated with them. I think we want to focus on how we use these technologies to affect the best societal outcomes rather than just opposing them altogether. The first thing I wanted to say is that even if all we were seeing was a change similar to what we've seen in the past, like the agricultural revolution of the 20th century, we want to be thinking pretty seriously about rethinking our institutions. So even if there wasn't that accelerating technological change, even if all we were seeing was something akin to what we've seen in the past, we'd want to make the kinds of changes, you know, changes on the scale that we have implemented in the past. The agricultural revolution, for example, was associated with the introduction of universal high school education in the US, driven by the states in the US that had particularly large numbers of agricultural workers. So I think that firstly, we should be thinking about policy responses on that scale. But I'd actually agree with your point that technology is accelerating away. And I think the response to that can only be to try and use technology in solving the consequent problems. So in skills, as you mentioned, obviously we're going to need to rethink education. The educational system we have today is equipping people for the workforce of the 20th century, let alone, you know, 20 years hence. And I think a big part of the solution to that is going to be in using technologies like MOOCs, as I mentioned before, in delivering, you know, education at scale and delivering education throughout a student's life, in freeing education from the classroom and enabling people to continue to acquire those skills as time goes on.
You ended up on, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. Yeah, you ended on a very optimistic note by suggesting that the kind of jobs which will remain or will in fact can grow will be things like interpersonal jobs, being a beach body coach, being a creative job, things like that. Things that we like doing, people like doing, and like having done as a service to them. But it seems to me there's no particular reason to suppose that that would necessarily be the case. I suppose I can think one reason to imagine that might happen is that if we have control over machine learning, that's the kind of jobs that we're not going to want to delegate to this machine learning. And I suppose you might also say those are the kind of things that humans are good at, and computers maybe not so good at. Although, you know, computers could learn to be good at them one day. But could you foresee? I mean, it might not happen like that. It might be that the jobs we end up with the jobs that computers can't do because they're just so menial or so boring. Or even, I mean, this is perhaps a rather extreme example, but there are people who say you might actually end up being effectively slaves of the computer. If maybe the computers will decide, well, it's not what humans want us to do, it's what we computers would quite like humans to do for us.
Right. Okay, well, speaking to the final point first again, I think it's still a bit misleading to think about these agents as having really strong desires of their own. I think, you know, there is this risk of anthropomorphizing our algorithms. That has led to many fallacies about what machine learning is capable of today. I tried to give some sense of the limitations of what we can do with these algorithms. All that said, I think there is a real concern looking further ahead, 50 years ahead, in considering what algorithms might do once fully intelligent, at least as intelligent as a human being. And
That's very much the focus of another program affiliated with the Martin School, the
Future of Humanity.
Future of Humanity Institute, of course, led by Professor Nick Bostring, who has an excellent book called Superintelligence on this topic. So I'd very much recommend you check that out. On the topic of whether or not it will actually be these creative jobs that are replaced, I mean, here again, I would just point to the inherent technical difficulties associated with these jobs. So I'm not saying that these jobs won't be automated because they're the jobs we want to keep. I'm saying that there are just fundamental technical difficulties in reproducing those tasks in code. If, you know, it is also possible, of course, that we might want to preserve them. There might be other factors at play, but even without making that assumption, these jobs are likely to remain where others don't.
Hi, I just want to bring it back to the question about the referee and accountability. So when the data sets get very large and perhaps beyond the scope of what one person can think about, and then your machine makes a decision, and then me as a user ask why.
Yeah.
And so how do you foresee machines describing, say if I'm a doctor and the machine says this is the treatment for you, and I ask why, do you see, how are you thinking about tackling that problem?
So this is a core research topic in machine learning. So it's probably well known to many of you that the state of the art in machine learning, so the use of systems like deep neural networks, that deep learning that's been getting a lot of press, are not transparent in the way that I think you were calling for. So a lot of algorithms in machine learning are still unable to provide us with the reasoning behind the decisions they make. And for that reason, a lot of the technologies we have are not suitable for those safety critical applications like medical diagnosis that you mentioned. So I would acknowledge that as a difficulty of, or sorry, as a weakness of what we currently have, but I don't see it as a fundamental limitation of the field as a whole. So our own theoretical work in machine learning is built upon more principled theoretical foundations, foundations of probability theory, which do allow a user much greater insight into why an algorithm arrives at the conclusion that it does. So that is a technical difficulty towards which much progress is being made. There are algorithms that can provide you with the causal factors that have led it to identify a particular strategy. And I just wanted to flag up, really, that is not something necessarily that is a problem for the field as a whole.
Great. Is there anyone else that wants to pose a question? Anyone, so just Clara doesn't have to walk all the way across. Anyone else? Yep, all right. It'll be the last question there. You got it, was it? Okay, last question over there. It wasn't this gentleman, it was the person at the back there.
Hi, yes. I was wondering, so one big improvement that machine learning can do is in a series sort of the manufacturing industry. For consumer industries, you know, there's a lot of free data flowing around. But for manufacturing industry, you know, companies are very protective and secretive about their data.
Yeah.
So how do you see that challenge being solved?
I think what you're speaking to there are the business plans of about a dozen startups that are in the process of being created. So, I mean, I agree with you entirely that there's a lot of value that machine learning can deliver to the manufacturing industry. You're absolutely right that that will require those industries to be a little bit more open with their data than they've been traditionally and to realize the value that's unlocked, that's locked up within it currently. Yes, there's enormous scope for automation in those spaces. I agree entirely.
Great. If you enjoyed this evening, this is part of a series of seminars on technology and society. The next one on Thursday 25th is on novel technologies for vaccine delivery by Christine Rolia. The following Thursday, the 3rd of March, is Ingmar Posner, as Mike mentioned, on navigating an autonomous future, driverless vehicles. There's a special event on Saturday, the 27th of February, that we're doing in conjunction with the Student Society, 21st Century Society, called Challenges of Our Century. And that's at the Mathematical Institute from 10 in the morning to 4 p.m. And the details are on our website of that and everything else. On the 2nd of March, we have our International Women's Day event, Professor Judah Wiseman of the Internet Institute, on automation, robotics, and the promise of an easier life. And what she's going to be doing, which I don't think anyone's ever done, is looking at the gender implications of what Michael is talking about. It's a really fascinating unpacking of this on gender dimensions. So that's on the 2nd of March. And then on 10th of May, looking further ahead, we have Blaise Aguirre E. Arcas, who's the principal scientist at Google, talking about Inside the Machine Mind, latest insights on neuroscience and computer science. So the intersection of neuroscience and computer science. That's just a small sample of what's happening here. Look at our website, do stay engaged. And thanks to you, Michael, for a really great introduction. And thanks to you all for coming.